quarter of an hour should be enough.
Okay. Whenever I'm at the end of this, I'll just stop.
Welcome everyone to the What Is seminar. Today we have Florian Frick here presenting us the ham sandwich theorem. So thank you, Florian, for coming and offering this talk to us. The stage is all yours.
Thank you for the introduction. Thanks for sticking around until, I don't know, until it's dark outside. Okay, so what is this about? I think originally it's motivated by this question. You have a sandwich and you have a lower slice of bread, you have ham and you have an upper slice of bread, and of course now you want to cut it in halves. You want to have equal amount of lower slice of bread and equal amount of ham and equal amount of upper slice of bread on both sides, and you have a very long knife. Can you always cut it in this way? If your sandwich looks nice, that's always possible. But if your sandwich looks very messy, the lower slice of bread is there, and your ham is there, and your upper slice of bread is there, is that still possible? That's an everyday problem, yes or no. And the answer is yes, that's always possible. You can always do that, and let's see what this theorem, let me try and formulate this theorem in a mathematical, precise way for you, and then see what this is about. So here's the theorem. Given D, let's say probability measures, in RP. So, for example, you could just think of compact sets and the density function is 1. And you want to cut those in half now. And we need one assumption, namely, given D probability measures, let me call them somehow mu1 up to mu d, such that each fine hyperplane in Rd, obviously, has measure 0 for each mu I. That's the one technical assumption we need. Then there exists in a fine hyperplane H and RD such that you have equal measures on both sides for each measure. So mu I of whatever is on the positive side of your hyperplane, let's call it H plus, maybe it's an oriented hyperplane, so this makes sense, is equal to mu I H minus for all I. So in dimension 3, this is really just this, you can cut a sandwich in this prescribed way. What is this in dimension 1? Let's prove this in dimension 1. We have one measure on the real line, and we want to find a point such that equal amount of measures to the left and to the right. That's very trivial, right? In dimension 1, what you just do is, the real line, you start somewhere here, very far to the left, start here, and just maybe you have 0 measure here and measure 1 on this side, and you just go further and further and further. This technical assumption just means this function will be continuous if you measure how much measures to this side. And once you fit one half, you stop. So follows from intermediate value theorem, right? And the question now is, there's some general feature hidden in there, so if you say, that's a stupid theorem, I don't care about it, my talk isn't really about the theorem, it's about the method of proof, that's involved here, which is very general and applicable in many, many instances. We have two things here, namely, so we need two ingredients. Let's look at two ingredients that are present here, and whenever they're present, we can try and use the proof that I'm presenting to you in a minute, which will be very simple. The two ingredients are, there's an inherent symmetry hidden here. There's some symmetry that's hidden here. What's the symmetry? Well, I chose an orientation, and I could have chosen it the other way around, then this equation would just flip. There's an inherent symmetry. And the second ingredient is, whether or not our statement is true can be measured by a continuous function. Truth of statement can be measured by a continuous function. Yeah, what kind of function would this be here? Well, how about for each measure, I look at the space of all the finite hyperplanes and I try the following. I compute this number minus this number. I get a vector of d entries, and if I find a hyperplane such that this vector is the zero vector, I'm done. And this function, I can build a continuous function that hits zero if and only if my statement is true. Once you have these two ingredients, which you have in very many cases, you're good to go and do whatever I'm about to do. Okay, let's see. So for the proof, and this is maybe the second thing to take home from this, if you see this, you can do it. And the second thing is, a characteristic of this is, the trivial case will be the intermediate value theorem. If you have anything where you say, hey, the trivial case is just the intermediate value theorem, then maybe the non-trivial case will be positive enough. Yeah. So what we'll need, one rule, is theorem of positive Boolean, Coulomb theorem, which generalizes the intermediate value theorem to higher dimensions, and I will state it in the following way, that f from SD to RD be a continuous function, with f of minus x is minus f of x. There you have your inherent symmetry. Then there exists some x in SD such that f of x is 0. Meaning this would be good for our case. Now we just construct such a function. This will allow the construction of this function in Vinner. Let's see that this is possible. So first of all, the lures need to understand what is the space of the fine hyperplanes in RD. Linear hyperplanes is very simple, right? Linear hyperplanes, those going to zero oriented ones, they're uniquely determined by the normal vector. And the normal vector is just an SD minus 1. So linear hyperplanes are SD minus 1. The fine hyperplanes are SD. And here's a way to see it. So fine, first thing to notice, the fine hyperplanes in RD, this space really is SD. Why is that? What you do is embed, or what I'm writing here is not exactly right. It's without north and south pole, but we'll see that this doesn't matter in a moment. Embed RD into RD plus 1 by just setting the last component with last coordinate 1. Maybe here's your R3, and you put your R2 here. And now if you have any affine hyperplane in R2, I don't know, maybe, did I see colored chalk? Green is very bad on green 4, but let me try. You You have some fine hyperplane in R2, it extends infinitely. What you do is you discode it, right? You have a bijection to linear hyperplanes in Rd plus 1 planes. Right? Just any fine alpha plane up here gives you a linear hyperplane, we're just saying N0 is also in there. And conversely, any linear hyperplane in Rd plus 1, either it cuts this up here and gives you an affine hyperplane, or it doesn't cut this, then it's exactly parallel to it. And that's why we exclude north and south. So I guess as a second thing I should write here, intersect linear hyperplanes in Rd plus 1 with this keeper. And that's your almost bijection of the little thing that you have to exclude these two points. Okay, and now let's just measure whether this is true, what we say here. The statement is true. So what's the function we look at? I've already said what we should look at as d without north and south pole to rd. X corresponds now to some oriented affine hyperplane in rd by this correspondence. So let's take this hyperplane and just see what each measure does. Mu1 of hx plus minus mu1 of hx minus, and so on, for every measure, mu d hx plus minus mu d hx minus. First thing is this technical assumption that every hyperplane has measure zero hopefully just translates into this function is continuous. If you don't believe it, then take anything where you're sure that it translates into this function is continuous. Secondly, since this is continuous and I just excluded north and south poles, and my function definitely doesn't go to infinity or something like this, it's probability measures, I can just extend my function into north and south pole. I can think of this as a continuous function on all of this. No problem. And now we just have to check what is phi minus x. What's with our inherent symmetry? Is this still present in this function, or have we lost it? Well, it's super simple, right? Instead of x, x corresponds to some linear hyperplane. The linear hyperplane cuts my one plane, my D plane up here, and gives me this affine hyperplane. What if instead of x, I take minus x? Well, I get the same linear hyperplane, so I get the same affine hyperplane, just the orientation is switched. In other words, these two terms switch. These two terms switch. So phi of minus x is minus phi of x. Right. So, by Bose-Ulam, or Bose to Ulam, by Bose-Ulam, there exists an x in SD such that phi of x is zero. It's not north or south pole. That's something we have to think about, but why is it not north or south pole? Well, if you take any x that's very close to the north pole, say, then this corresponds to affine hyperplanes that are very far out. So the measure on one side will be 1 and on the other it will be 0. So it's not north or south pole, so this corresponds really to an affine hyperplane in Rd, and this means we're done. This means phi I of hx plus is mu I, right? And that's already the proof of this theorem. And as you see, that might be applicable in many other situations. So I still have this much short. I could, whatever you want. I could tell you about other applications. You can ask questions. However you like this talk to go on.
Show some applications, sure?
Sure, I could show, how about this? Yeah, here's a theorem that's essentially very simple linear algebra that people care about. Gordon's theorem says the following. Given b plus 2 points in Rd, there is a partition of these b plus 2 points into two sets, sigma and tau, such that the convex hull of sigma intersection the convex hull of tau is non-empty, which basically just means, so for me this theorem just says there are two kinds of people, and the two kinds of people there are the following. There are those that draw a tetrahedron like this, and then there are other people and draw a tetrahedron like this. And both of them have the same problem. Either this vertex lies on top of this triangle, or if you avoid this, this edge intersects this opposite edge. One of the two problems you must always have. That's what Gordon's theorem says. And now the question is, okay, but this is a straight line drawing. Now I'm really clever. I don't want a straight line drawing. I just want a continuous drawing. Is this still true? And that's the topological theorem. So I think this is 79 by Motzki and Bahn, so Hungarian people. If you have a continuous map from the D plus 1 simplex, yeah, this is the 3 simplex, 4 simplex is the cone over this, just D plus 1 simplex means any d plus 2 vertices, any d plus 2 points in Rd in general position take the convex hull, that's a d plus 1 simplex. For any continuous map from here to there, so for any drawing of the tetrahedron into the plane, say, for d equal to 2, for this, there are two disjoint faces, sigma and tau of delta d plus 1, such that, again, they overlap in Yermisch. So we have the same problem when we allow ourselves to draw with squiggly lines, which might be expected, but... So, how would you prove this? Well, again, I don't have to maybe write down the whole proof for you, tell you the idea is exactly the same. What's the inherent symmetry? Why does this have an inherent symmetry? Well, we don't care whether sigma and tau overlap or whether tau and sigma overlap. That's the inherent symmetry. Why can we measure this via a continuous function? Well, our space of all possibilities is the space of, I have pairs of faces that are disjoint. I have to find out what is the space. And luckily, it'll turn out to be the D-sphere, or at least contain the D-sphere. And then I can ask, hey, what is f of some point in this phase minus f of some point in this disjoint phase? And I'll do the same thing. I get, hey, it has a zero, I'm done. Right? That's a good thing. The question is, the funny thing here is, you can prove this theorem instead of for an intersection of two things, you can prove it for an intersection of r things. If you have, instead of d plus 2 points, you have r minus 1, d plus 1, plus 1. R minus 1, d plus 1, plus 1. If you have that many points in Rd, you have an r-fold intersection of this kind. You can partition this into r sets that overlap. That's Twerberg's theorem. The funny thing is, what happens if you want to prove a topological Twerberg's theorem. This is known only for R prime power. And it's extremely hard to prove using spectral sequences and so on. Very, very difficult to prove. Otherwise, in dimension greater than 2 and R not a prime power is completely unknown. So there's funny things going on, things we don't understand. Okay, I think I'll just stop here and give you the opportunity to ask questions. If you have any.
I guess your talk was just too comprehensible.
Too comprehensible. I should throw in some other stuff.
Can you say again what the north and the south pole happens there?
Ah, yeah, okay. It's, so the one picture I can draw is two-dimensional, right?
Half the time is over.
My time is gone. So what was this construction? I put, in this case, R to the 1 at height 1. And I take any linear hyperplane in here. Okay, that's not very linear, but it goes, you get my, get what I'm saying, it goes through here. It cuts here, right? It determines a fine hyperplane in R1, which is just a point. But this hyperplane, which is exactly here, or the differently oriented counterpart, this hyperplane, they don't determine such a hyperplane up here. That's why we have to exclude north and south pole first, but then can continuously extend.
Yeah, and the continuous extension has a natural interpretation where in one orientation, say the north pole, the positive side is the entire space and the negative side is the empty set,
right.
And the opposite in the opposite case.
I think it would be nicer to not do this in RD but in RPD, where you have a hyperplane at infinity.
Right.
Right.
But then orientation is less.
Yes. So let me mention, if you're interested in these kinds of things, people in Berlin do this, right? So right next door, Animal A2, Güterzigler, Pablo Dragojevic, Animal A2, wherever it is, somewhere this way.
That way.
Don't go this way, go that way. Yes. Other questions or comments?
You say that you have to define some spy here to put the parabolic problem?
Yes, so the space you're looking at is just this one. X, y in simplex times simplex. Yeah, you want pairs of faces, you want pairs of things and see whether they intersect or overlap. And what you have is X and Y are in disjoint spaces. That's the space you're looking at. And the great thing is the D-sphere embeds into this in a way that if you go from x to minus x here, you just do this here, you just interchange the two things. And that's what, and then do exactly this. It's really, it's just the same.
Well, phases are the top level things or?
No, phases is anything that can be cut out of this by,
oh, okay.
by a hyperplane that's supporting.
So it's the same as building the projective sphere when you associate two vertices that are polar?
It
looks a bit like that.
It kind of has something to do with it, right? The symmetry you have here, of course, if you quotient by it, you get projective space, right?
Yeah. Last chance for a question.
Oh, that's good.
Let's thank Florian again.